Clair Harwood, thanks for joining us today. How are you?
Oh, I'm very well, thank you, Ben. Thank you for inviting me.
So I know we're going to talk about a lot of different stuff, but we're going to focus on bees because you're a bee expert, right?
Well, yes. No, I adore bees. I love bees. I've been working with them, bless you, for a few years now. I wouldn't call myself an expert, but I'm hugely passionate about them.
You're very modest, but you do have a lot of knowledge about bees.
Yeah.
certainly, go on.
No, I was going to say it's surprising actually how much knowledge you do pick up on a subject when you sort of you've been reading or getting involved with something for a few years. So yeah, it's I suppose you have more knowledge than the next person, but you underestimate it, I think, sometimes.
So, give us an overview. How long have you been involved with bees? When did you first become interested? And what stuff have you done in your period of bee fascination?
It was I think it was about 2013, so about 5 years ago is when I first got involved. And before then, I didn't really have any interest whatsoever. It wasn't on my radar. I didn't even like the taste of honey, if I'm honest. But it was just a really random day. About 5 years ago, and I walked past a couple of beehives, and something just clicked in my brain, and that was the connection. And it's just been a love affair ever since.
So, but why the fascination? Because you're really into it, aren't you? You're kind of, you've got this deep connection with bees. And so what's that about? What do they mean to you?
Yeah, you're right. There is a deep connection, and they mean so much to me. I can sound really cheesy, but just on so many levels as well. I think they've taught me so much, and they continue to teach me so much. And I think maybe just not me, and maybe just not bees, but I think there's a lot of stuff going on at the minute where a few subjects have been steeped in mystery for a lot of years, and it seems like a lot of information and knowledge is kind of coming up to the surface now. So, yeah,
So, yeah, keep going.
no, I was just going to sort of say it's hard to sort of put your finger on it, but there's lots of elements for what really kind of does it for me with bees and their communication, for example. And you just with it's, and it's not just bees, but I think there's just new research coming out on a daily basis, which is so exciting with bees as well. And it's bridging that gap between a lot of old ancient knowledge and now new scientific research, which I think we're seeing in a lot of fields. So it is really exciting.
So who is actually studying bees in a scientific way? Is there universities or something? How does it work?
Yes, yeah, loads of universities are studying. It's usually it's kind of the departments of zoology is what it falls under, because I was kind of thinking, oh, what do I do with this passion? Do I go and study it? And but there's so much work being done. There's the centre. I'm going to get all these facts wrong probably. The Centre of Ecology and Hydrology, I think, in Oxfordshire, they do a lot of work. There's loads of organisations that are just kind of really got their fingers on the pulse, which is I'm so grateful. And yeah, lots of research going on all across the world as well, and that's nice because the beekeeping community is actually quite a small community. So the researchers and the scientists, and it's not just the scientists as well. There's the beekeepers that have been keeping bees for years. They're up in the game as well, just giving, because experience is one of the best things with beekeeping as well. Because
I was just going to ask. So, walk us through this because I'm one of those people. I don't know much about it, but I've heard people like several years ago, they were saying like the bees are disappearing and stuff, and it could be catastrophic because if there's no bees, then everything else dies. But I don't understand anything about that. So, what's going on with that? Is that still going on? Is there still like a shortage of bees, or what is it?
Yeah, I don't know. There's really kind of mixed messages on it. And yeah, you're right. That is kind of the doom and gloom message that I think it was Einstein that said, if the bees disappear, it'll take 4 years for man to follow, purely because they pollinate our food. But there's so many different factors affecting the bees at the minute. Some are kind of mainstream beliefs and theories, and some are, I guess, a little bit out there. But I think the main thing is the food and the pollination, and obviously a lot of the pesticides that are going on the food, and just how our food is being produced now is very different to how it used to be. So there was a lot more variety for bees to forage. But now, you know, you're seeing just universal landscapes of one type of crop, for example, which is being sprayed. So I think that is the main concern, I think, when it comes to bees. But there's also theories about the electromagnetic frequencies, I guess, going now in our environment with Wi-Fi signals, lots of different things, because bees, they work through kind of electromagnetic communication. So there's a theory that interferes with bees as well. So
what do you mean they got like electro radars that they talk to each other with or something?
Yeah, they do. I mean, they communicate, this is where I'm not an expert. So they do communicate kind of electromagnetically. They have magnetic plates in their stomach, in their guts. I think that's how they kind of communicate with one another and to their environment as well. And I remember, just going back a few years, at one of Ian Crane's conferences, actually, there's a woman from Finland who, she was kind of adamant that the increase in air pollution, but not kind of pollution with toxins, but the electromagnetic pollution that was going on, that was having a big effect on bees. But yeah, pheromones are a big thing as well. It's not kind of not just, they don't just communicate through electromagnetic frequencies, but through pheromones. But it's the same how you see kind of murmurations of starlings, or, you know, how they just move in one big entity, I suppose, or fishes, or like schools of fishes, how they all move as one. Bees work in a similar way to that. So it's just a, yeah.
So we do understand how they communicate, do we? Like with the, like you said, with the fish and the birds and the bees, do we actually understand it, or is it still a mystery?
I think we're definitely getting to understand it. And this is the great thing about the research that's coming through. There's a lot of mystery still, especially with bees, because bees have been being kept for thousands of years, but I think scientists have only really started studying them for a few hundred years, if that, maybe 200 or 300 years. I'm probably making that up. But we are starting to understand it, and there's just some really cool, exciting stuff going on with regards to the communication. But it's getting it's changing as well. Like, I mean, the queen bee, for example, she makes a noise which is referred to as piping. It's a really high-pitched noise, and I think that's always been a bit of a mystery, and scientists have been trying to understand what this is, this piping noise. And so I think they had one theory about it, about certain noises would mean that she was going to swarm. But, you know, in a couple of weeks, or 2 or 3 weeks later, another theory will come up. So I think that's the thing with bees and other research, is it can just get kind of trumped when a new piece of research comes up. But
right. So it's constantly evolving.
Yeah, it is. But there's some great stuff. There's at Kew Gardens in London, they built, I think it was in 2017, they built a huge hive, aluminium hive, and there was two beehives in there, and the scientist, I think his name is Martin Benzik, he studies at Nottingham, or lectures, sorry, at Nottingham Trent University. And they kind of rigged up two beehives to this huge multi-sensory lattice tower, and recorded the bees' communications, they rigged up lights and sound to try and reflect what was going on inside the beehive. So that was just such a cool project that they did, and just to try and show humans the different types of communication that was going on. And Wolfgang Buttress was the artist who created this big metal tower. And then they got some musicians involved from the band Spiritualize, and they actually did some concerts just to kind of show and let humans feel the what was going on in the hive through light, through sound. And it was quite interesting that they found that the bees, the main tone that came from the beehives was the key of C. I'm not a musician, but you are, Ben. So, and I think it was C sharp as well. And so, yeah, just loads of interesting things like that. And projects are coming up just to try and understand more about the bees, really.
Did you attend that?
I did, and I didn't get an opportunity to, unfortunately, but I went, I bought the album. There's an album called B1, which is what this group created, and it's amazing. It's really, really cool. But no, I would like to see it.
Talk us through the life cycle of a bee. Like, what do they do? What do they get up to? How do they reproduce? What's the whole deal with the queen, you know, the matriarchy?
Yeah, it's quite cool. I find it really sweet because throughout the bee's lifetime, they just have loads of different jobs. And it's just the females that work in the hive. So you've got the queen, and then you've got her sisters and her daughters. And so it's a female and existence in the colony, and the bees will live there from larvae to being born, I suppose, is 21 days. And the bee, depending on when it's born in the year, will live for either 3 weeks if it's in the summertime, or if it's during the winter, can live up to 3 months or so. But they do have different jobs throughout their life cycle. So one of the first jobs when a bee is born is to be a nurse bee, where she will feed other younger bees that are coming out of their cells. And then they can move on to different roles. So there's janitor bees, which will keep the hive clean. You have guard bees that will sit outside the hive, just making sure no dodgy ones come into the hive.
Like what might come in?
Well, you can get like drones, the male bees. Sometimes they might have to get turned away, and or predators. So wasps, for example, can come in.
So what are they looking for?
They'll steal the honey. They'll want the honey, but they are carnivorous wasps as well. But I'd say this could be a lie, but I don't know if they feed on the young. I could be making that up. I know that there's a new threat from Asian hornets that have come in, and what they do is they do hunt and feed off the bees.
Not all bees are carnivorous, but some of them are. Is that what you're saying?
So wasps are, they're carnivorous, but bees, but all bees, I think, bumblebees, honeybees, they're not, so they just,
So what are some of the other differences between bees and wasps then? Like, what function do wasps perform?
I don't know a huge amount about wasps. They are pollinators, so I love wasps just as much, to be honest, but wasps have nests as well. So if you see a wasp's nest, it's kind of quite like paper. It's very beautiful and intricate inside. But they don't produce, I don't know if they produce honey, actually. I'm not too sure about that. But they don't kind of produce wax like bees do. The hives are very different.
So what do bees eat then?
Bees will eat, they'll kind of forage within their 5 kilometer radius. So when the bees kind of finish their little jobs inside the hive, they'll then go on to become scout bees, forager bees. So they'll go out and they'll eat. They like a variety of things. So that's why there's a big push on wildflower meadows at the minute, to try and bring back variety for the bees and the forage. They love borage. Apparently they love the bluey violet kind of flowers, so lavender, borage, clover, but it is mainly, well, pollen. So they go and collect two things. They'll collect pollen and nectar. And the pollen will provide the protein for the new bees coming up, and the nectar, they'll come back and bring it to the hive and kind of they'll fan their wings to evaporate the water out of the nectar, which will then turn into honey. And that smells beautiful. Like on a summer's evening, when you sit next to the hive, you can just smell, you can hear the fanning going on. It sounds like a at a fan, and then it's just the smell is divine. So yeah.
So do they collect nectar or do they produce it?
They collect the nectar from the flowers.
Oh, I see. So and then they dry it out, and then that becomes honey.
Yeah, so they the pollen they collect on their, they've got little pollen baskets on their back legs, so the pollen is collected, and that's when you see bees, they'll have like these like little yellow clumps on them, that's the pollen they've collected. And also you go and buy it in health food shops, obviously big jars of pollen. The nectar, as far as I'm aware, they eat the nectar, so they have long tongues, bees, so they suck up the nectar from the flowers. And they come back and they kind of regurgitate it a little bit, and then it's stored in the cells, and then the water is evaporated out of it and it's turned into honey.
Okay, this shows how little I know. I thought they made like honey in their tummy or something. They squirt it out or something.
Well, that's probably more correct. I mean, this is, again, my is, there's gonna be loads of beekeepers now leaving comments going, no, that's not right at all what she's saying. But yeah, that's what they collect, pollen and nectar, which is kind of sugar and protein, really, which is what bees, so water, sugar, protein. They collect water as well, so if for bees, it's good to have a water supply next if you want to help the bees out as well.
So you said it's only the females that are inside the what's it called, the nest, what's it called,
they're in the hive. The colony is kind of the collective, the term for it, that, yeah.
So then does that mean it's the males that are going out doing the pollen and all that?
No, the males don't forage. The only purpose of the males, as far as we're aware, this is a subject that I'm really interested in, is to mate with the queen. It's just the females that go and forage and do everything. They run the whole colony. The males literally will eat the honey. I mean, a lot of beekeepers will laugh. They'll say all the men do is just eat and have sex. I guess that's true, but I think research is kind of looking, I think there's a lot of mystery around the male bees, but as it stands, yeah, they will mate with the queen, and then when it comes to the summer, all throughout the spring and summer, the drones, the male bees, will be allowed in the hive to eat their honey to the heart's content. But when it comes to autumn, winter time, the females will kick them out of the hive and they'll die. So either way, the drone's existence is kind of very short.
Oh, right. So it really is a matriarchy then.
Yeah, it is. And even if the male, and when they mate with the queen, if they mate with the queen, they'll die as well. So either way.
Oh, right. So if they mate with the queen, they die.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Man, they got it rough, haven't they?
Well, yeah, I don't know. I guess so. They sort of know what's going on, though, I think. But she'll mate with about 30 or 40 males in her mating flight. But it's funny you say that they get it rough, because I sort of feel like the queen gets it rough a little bit. She only leaves the hive once in her lifetime, and whereas all the other females, they get to go out and forage, and she can live from anything up to sort of three to five years, the queen, and she only leaves once, so... And then she's just in the hive the rest of her days laying eggs.
Wow, incredible. So how many eggs will a queen lay in her lifetime?
In her lifetime, it's tens of thousands, but she lays about 2,000 to 3,000 eggs a day.
And then really?
She lives kind of three to five years. That's a lot.
2,000 to 3,000 eggs a day?
Yeah. What? Yep. And she'll mate with, up to 30 drones, and then she'll collect all the semen from those drones. They'll all die, and that will be enough to keep her going, to lay the eggs. Jesus. And fertilise whether she wants females or males.
Oh, my God. Wow.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
Let's go back to... Like, so what does this mean to you? I know I kind of asked you that earlier, but what does it mean to you?
It feels like it means to me, there's so many things it means to me, actually. I find beekeeping really healing. It came into my life when I think I needed some healing as well. I've always been into sort of alternative therapies and healing, but I think the biggest thing is it feels like this is what I'm here to do. So it feels like a bit of a responsibility almost, or a duty that this, and I'm not quite sure where it's going to go, but I feel like it's a calling, I suppose.
I was just going to say that, yeah.
Yeah. And it's, so for me, that's the biggest thing, really. And it just brings so much joy, you know, and so much love. I love being around the bees, and when you're handling them and dealing with them, it's the smell. It's, they say that beekeeping is one of, it's a craft or a hobby where it kind of tickles all six of your senses. And there's not many things that do that, you know, if you believe you've got six senses. Where it's the smell, the sound, the touch of the bees. But I just feel like it does. I mean, they use beekeeping, the Help for Heroes, for example, use beekeeping to treat people with PTSD. And I think they're still looking into to why that is. But it's a really mindful craft to practice, because you do have to be calm. You do have to be quite chilled. And I just find it really healing in lots of ways. And I'd love to go and work with other people with beekeeping and just see kind of what doors it opens. And I just really believe that the bees are trying to help us. They're very selfless creatures. And I think it's taught me a lot about how to work as part of a whole. And it's difficult not to compare humans and humanity with bees sometimes as well. And you just see how the bees operate, and they're not out for themselves or... you know, it's not kind of survival of the fittest. They just work, they do their jobs for the good of the whole colony, which, and then they kind of accept the fact that there's cycles and life is just a cycle. So it's quite sweet, really, when a bee is coming towards the end of her life, she'll just leave the hive because she knows that she might not be as much use to the hive anymore. So yeah, I just learn a lot, and I love to learn. And I think the bees, they really make me question a lot of things. And so I don't know if that answers your question, but there's just so many things why it kind of feels that that's what I'm meant to be doing, and but in lots of different ways.
And you've worked for a magazine. What was your role with that?
That was, I was deputy editor for Beecraft magazine, and that was just such a blessing to work for Beecraft. You have Clair Wearing, who's the editor. She's been the editor for Beecraft, gosh, I think about 20 years now. But they are just the like the creme de la creme of in the beekeeping world, and I was lucky and fortunate to work with them. And as I said, I was deputy editor. I then was kind of hosting some of their Beecraft live hangouts on YouTube, and I learned so much, and I got to attend the Honey Show and work with them. And also it kind of tickled both of my interests. I love writing, I love words, and it kind of got me into editing as well, and just to see what work goes into producing a magazine every month as well. So I was so fortunate to work in that industry, and plus it was about bees. So when you're proofreading a magazine every couple of weeks, and you're just learning, you're absorbing all that information. So yeah, so I was very, and it's good to have those contacts. I mean, Claire, she was approached by Haynes, you know, the Haynes manuals for cars.
Oh, yeah.
Her and her husband, Adrian, were approached to write one for beekeeping. So I've got a lovely signed copy of that, and it's a cracking book as well. So it's just good to sort of, it's just wonderful to meet all those people there and work with them. But then obviously I moved, and I've moved up to Scotland now, so I wasn't able to continue that role, but very blessed.
Have you been involved with beekeeping in Scotland?
I've kind of made my connections so far, because obviously we're in the winter season now, so the spring season's not going to kick off to kind of like April, May time. And I've connected with, first things first is you've got to join your local association, but I've connected with a beekeeper up here called Erling Watt, and he's gonna hopefully be my new mentor, and he's got an apiary just around the corner from me. So but unfortunately he had some of his beehives stolen a few months ago. Which is a shame. It's kind of, that's happening a lot everywhere. So it's just, it's going to be good because I'm going to learn how to, well, hopefully help him rebuild his apiary.
Isn't that weird? Like, it seems like such a niche topic. It's hard to believe that people that are knowledgeable about bees would steal hives.
Yeah, I know. And you'd think, because you would have to have a certain amount of knowledge to go in, you know, it's, you're handling 80,000 bees and, you know, if you piss bees off, they come at you. So you've got to have a certain amount of knowledge to go in and do that, so, which also makes me think you would know how much care and love and attention and time has gone in.
It's very odd, isn't it? I mean, I could understand someone like stealing a bike and selling it at the pub, but like a beehive, that's a peculiar thing to rob, isn't it?
Yeah, and I don't know, I mean, I think maybe people have got more knowledge on it. I don't know if it's just for the honey, because obviously honey is expensive. In one beehive you could have, I don't know, about 500 quid's worth of honey or whatever. But then I don't know if it is the whole hive. I think some maybe just steal it for the honey, but then that just is really distressing because those poor bees are all just going to die as well, which is, because for me it was never really about the honey getting into beekeeping, although when you work with honey it's quite a magical substance, but it was just the bees for me. So it's sad to think that they could just all die for the sake of someone wanting to steal a bit of honey.
Is there, so can you get the honey without killing them?
Yeah, yes, yeah. You just, the thing with honeybees is they're called honeybees because they produce more honey than they need. So you do, if you just keep adding layers or boxes to your beehive, the bees will just fill it up, but that's not what beekeepers do, obviously. But you can, you'll have a section of your hive where the queen, you have a queen excluder, so she cannot go up into that other super, they're called supers, to lay brood. So it will literally just be the honey. So that's how beekeepers will just take that, and the bees will have enough honey for them as well.
So it's like a surplus thing.
Yeah, exactly. Right. Which is why they're called supers, because it's like you have a surplus. I don't know what the word is, but.
And under what circumstances will bees attack? Like, what has to happen? Like on my girl.
Oh yeah. If you just piss them off, really, or if they're distressed, if you sort of go in thumping about, you know, banging about, they're not going to like that. If they feel like they're being attacked or threatened, because, as you know, bees, they'll die if they sting you. Wasps won't, but bees will. So they really don't want to attack you. Mm. And if they do, obviously their venom, their sting will produce a venom and the pheromone. And that usually then tells other bees that they're being threatened. So they'll come and attack you as well. And it's not a nice experience. I did actually experience it just before I moved up to Scotland when we were moving my bees to someone else's apiary, and it was like a big black cloud just coming towards you, and it's, yeah. It's
all right. Quite,
yeah.
So they go into like an attack mode. So once they're in that mode, there's nothing you can do about it. They're in that mode.
Yeah, definitely. And they do work as one, really. So, yeah.
Could it kill a human?
I don't think they, well, depending on the human state, really, on if they, what they're, because it kind of affects, the venom is, affects your blood and your oxygen in your blood. So I think it all depends on the human state, but no, honeybees typically wouldn't kill a human. I think hornets can be known to kind of hurt young children or babies, could potentially have life-threatening impacts there. And then you've got the Africanized honeybees, which are called the killer bees as well. They do say that they can kill a human, and they say that they have killed humans, but we don't have them in that in this country. So, but I'm intrigued by those bees, the killer bees, because they are they're meant to be known to be extra aggressive. However, they are immune to a lot of the diseases that are affecting other bees. I feel like there's some interesting research that could be done there, because there's lots of medicinal uses from the honey and the venom from bees. So I think if they're extra spiky, then they might be holding some secrets.
What is there any interest in esoteric information about bees that's not quite so, there's a little bit more out there, like, because I know you're kind of open-minded to all sorts of stuff, so I mean,
definitely,
come on, give us some wacky, give us some wacky stuff.
No, you're right, I absolutely love it. And again, this is just, and I think with bees as well, the thing that it's, I love is I follow my intuition with bees a lot. You know, you can sort of feel them in a way. You feel if they're upset or angry, and that was just something that just came naturally to me. I'm quite an intuitive person, and I used to love to sit and meditate next to my bees. And then I just started to go a bit more deeply into it, and there's a couple of books. I started reading a book called The Shamanic Way of the Bee by a guy called Simon Buxton, and he talks about how it's a real feminine practice, beekeeping, and unlocked lots of mysteries with kind of sexuality as well, and the feminine power, I suppose. And the bee, so there's, you can go and do a shamanic course in beekeeping, and they kind of say, oh, it's, you know, it's for women only, and you can do healing with beekeeping and the sound, going back to the sound and the frequencies, which I'm really interested in.
Can you hear it yourself with, or is it like supersonic or something?
Yeah, I mean, I think you can feel it. You know when you know like Tibetan monks, when they chant their mantras, apparently that's also in the tone of the key of C. And it's a bit like that. You expect this crazy buzz when you open a beehive, but it's actually just this really nice hum. And I believe that, yeah, it does something to your cells, your body. Absolutely, I really do. You know, that's why we have kind of the gong baths or the crystal singing bowls. I feel it's the same kind of healing. And then very recently, I've read some lectures. I don't know if you know Rudolf Steiner. Have you've heard of Rudolf Steiner before?
That's the Steiner founder, is it?
Yeah, yeah. And I read just on Google, I found it was called Bee Lectures by Rudolf Steiner. And the stuff he was coming out with was just amazing. And he talks about, kind of goes into a little bit of the sacred geometry of bees and beekeeping, because obviously you've got the hexagonal comb shaped where the bees, that's the shape that the bees make their combs in. And he sort of talks about, and also if you know crystals, how crystals are formed when they come out of the earth, they're also in quite in a hexagonal shape, and you've got things like Giant's Causeway, and just how this shape is very sacred. And I'm still learning about this subject, but his kind of take on it is it is a very spiritual practice, and what honey does to the cells in the human body. And he kind of compares the hive itself and the cells as the working of the human body, which is really interesting. But yeah, I am still kind of getting my head around it all, but it's for me, when you work with them, I mean, I know straight after I've kind of been working with bees or had my head in a hive, you're giddy afterwards, and you're buzzing, excuse the pun, and it's such a lovely feeling. So I know from experience what it does to the body. And it is exciting, but definitely the spiritual side is, I'm really interested in that, and the healing side of it. And beekeeping is huge in Germany, for example, and they have things called bee houses in Germany, which is just like a shed, to be fair, and you've got a kind of an observation hive in the shed. So you've got the beehive, but with perspex plastic and wax candles burning, and the sound of the bees, and they do put people in there for healing and just relaxation.
Oh, I see. Right. So yeah, I see. So being around the bees is healing and therapeutic.
Yeah. And then the honey as well. I just think there's lots of, obviously it's, and you look, you know, back in time, you had Aristotle was a beekeeper. The Egyptians kept bees. And I was talking to someone the other day about Napoleon really interested in this, in the symbolism of the bee as well, because it kind of goes back to the fleur-de-lis symbol, the bee it does. So Napoleon would have bees all over his robes, just for the power of the symbol.
What's the fleur-de-lis? I can't remember. I feel like, yeah, I should know.
Yeah, you will know. It's kind of like a little gold flower looking symbol. So there's three, and it looks a bit like an iris. I think the flower iris is kind of formed from the fleur-de-lis. I'll send you a picture.
Okay.
but some people sort of think the fleur-de-lis, because there's three leaves, represent the Holy Trinity, like the soul, the spirit, and the human body. The Trinity thing.
What's going on with your books, your writing?
So I've written a children's book and about bees, and I'm on the second one at the minute, and I'm working with an illustrator who's illustrating it for me. And again, that was kind of a bit of an intuitive, because I love to write articles about bees, but I didn't really expect to write children's books, but I was sitting meditating, like I said, next to them, and then this book kind of just kind of formed. So I'm going to write a series of them called The Wee Little Bees, and the first one is called Made with Love, and I'm really excited, and I can't wait to kind of get that out to the world. Be spring next year. So
is it going to be a physical print?
Yes, yeah, it will be. I'm still debating how I'm going to get it out there and then publish it, because I've met with a couple of publishers, but I really want to work with schools and libraries I'm going to do an audio book with it as well, and get people reading it out loud. A lot of the children's books in the past on bees have either been too fantasy, and completely factually incorrect, or they've been too kind of educational heavy. So the one that I've written is a bit of a balance. So it's, yeah, a bit fantasy, a bit cheesy, but I've kind of wanted to make sure that there's some bee facts in there, because I think education about bees is really important. And I'm really into learning about the dark European honeybee, or the wild bees, at the moment. So I've kind of based the book around that species of bee as well.
And how has Scotland changed you?
It's done exactly what I wanted it to do. I mean, that the whole point of coming up here, well, one of the main reasons was because it's, in my opinion, a bit wilder up here, that you've got things still intact, like fresh air, fresh clean water, the strain of bee, the dark European honeybee, or the black bees, are native to the British Isles, and they're thriving more up in Scotland and in Ireland. And I think it's because it is a tougher environment, a tougher climate up in Scotland and Ireland. So I guess humans haven't really messed about as much with nature, or the bees are still a little bit wild. So it's one of the big reasons I came, because I wanted to learn about them, and they are kind of on the bit, they're protected species as well, because a lot of people in the past sort of, well, kind of since the 70s, a lot of different queens have been imported into the UK, sort of Italian, more docile bees, and the wild bees, as they are a little bit wilder, a little bit more aggressive, but again, they're immune, well, not immune, but they resist better from a lot of diseases that are affecting the bees down south. Their honey, they kind of produce a lot of honey. Because they have this theory that bees can't fly in the wind and the rain, and where I've moved up to is the most northern easterly point of Scotland, where it's really windy and really rainy, and you just see the bees, not now obviously because it's winter, but you could see them flying in really strong wind and rain. Bless these little bumblebees, and they're so cute, gripping onto the trees. But And you see them. So that's just blown that theory out of the water, really. And the wildlife up here is incredible. And I do think that's because it hasn't been messed around with humans as much. So, and I sort of got, I'm learning a lot about the humans as well, and I can't help but compare. It's just, I think, really tough, resilient people as well as wildlife. So I've loved it. I've loved moving up here, and it's kind of doing exactly what I wanted it to do. But all these things come with their tests as well. So
yeah, right. Like outside of bees, like what have you been up to, you know, besides that?
I've been doing a little bit of my freelance editing still. I'm working on a couple of books with really a couple of really good friends of mine. And I've also got involved with the business improvement district in the town where I'm living in Peterhead, which is all about regenerating the town centre. I think this part of Scotland, the northeast of Scotland, is just beautiful. It's in Aberdeenshire, but I think it's gone through a lot of tough times over the past few years. So there's a lot of regeneration that needs to happen. And I feel I kind of wasn't really expecting to fall into that position, but I feel really lucky that I have, because there's such a really strong community feeling up here where everyone really cares about what happens. So that's been great. I've been doing that kind of working, the 9-to-5 work. And there's a lot of talent up here as well, like music and art. And so it's really nice to be around that. And I feel like I've come at a time where all of this stuff is just kind of, again, bubbling to the surface and wanting to be seen. And there's rich history around where I am as well, loads of history and about, you know, pirates and witches. And it's quite a gothic sort of Scandinavian Viking energy to it, which is new to me. And I'm really happy to soak it all up. You'll have to come and visit soon. Well, we can talk about that when you're going to come up soon, hopefully.
Yes. All right. Yeah. yes, I will. Anytime. Good. After Christmas.
Yeah.
Okay, so where can people find you? Like website or email? What's best?
Probably email, Ben. I kind of did the whole I'm coming off social media thing for a year, which was fantastic. But I am back on it now, just on Facebook. And it'll probably be Facebook will be the best place to follow me or find me.
Have you got a page?
No, it's just my personal page. But what I have got, which I'm going to be adding a lot more material to, is the site Medium, which is for writers.
Oh, okay. I don't
know.
I think
if you check Medium out, actually, I've got a page on Medium, which is where I'm going to do most of my posting and writing on. But I will, once the children's book has kind of taken shape, I'll also have a website for the wee little bees. So nothing solid yet I can offer you, but I'll definitely keep you posted. And
yeah, cool. Send me the link to that Medium thing so I can post it on the description.
Yeah, okay, I will. Thank you. Yeah.
Well, thanks for taking the time to speak to us. That was really interesting.
Oh, thank you. Thanks a lot for inviting me. It's only taken you 8 years to get me on your podcast. No, I'm kidding.
I've known you longer than that.
I know. I was looking back on all your videos and it's just so impressive what you've done as well. So no, I'm really, really grateful to be on here. Thank you, Ben.
Yeah, I've gone in and out of different phases. Like there's been times where I've done like loads of videos and there's times where I don't. And like just this last couple of weeks, I decided to get back on it again. And I'm really enjoying it because I've kept it really simple this time. Mm. In the past, I used to do video and it's almost like I overcomplicated it really and made it, you know, sort of a bit difficult for myself. But just doing audio is much simpler, just in terms of like getting the podcast up. It's much quicker and easier, and you know, don't have to put a shirt on and do my hair and stuff and sort of get the lighting right. You know, it all takes time.
Yeah,
and all
that. Definitely.
So it's nice just doing audio. Yeah. And also I don't have any outcome or any agenda with this. I'm just like talking to anyone who's got something interesting to talk about. And you know, I'm not selling anything. There's no, you know, it's totally relaxed, you know, which is nice.
No, that's brilliant. It's just nice to sort of sit, like you said, and chat to people. And it's really good.
All right then, Claire, I'll leave you to it. Thanks. And I'll upload this and send you the links later.
Lovely. Thanks, Ben.
All right.
Take care. Lots of love.
You too. Bye. Bye.